Shabbat Shalom and Chag Sameach, everyone. I want to thank our friends who are here in room 2425, and I want to thank our friends who are joining us on live stream. Let me frame the class this way. I'm not trying to be deliberately provocative. I just want to share with you what I thought and felt. I was in shul on the first 2 days of Sukkot, and I noticed that two of the haftarot for Sukkot prominently feature Shlomo HaMelech, King Solomon. But the reason is an innocuous, innocent reason, which is the way that Sukkot was celebrated was lots of animal sacrifices. I mean, thousands of animals get sacrificed. That was what they did back then to celebrate the holiday. And, of course, where do you do it? You do it at the temple in Jerusalem. And how is it that we have a temple in Jerusalem? We used to have this wandering Mishkan, this portable sanctuary that we spend a lot of half the book of Exodus building. So how we have a temple? Well, answer, King Solomon builds the temple. Two of the haftarot on Sukkot therefore feature the temple, where all those animal sacrifices were featured and performed. So far, so good. But in those haftarot, and you'll see, King Solomon has a very outsized role. There's a lot of me. I get to build it. I build it. My dad didn't build it. I build it. I'm the hero. And then he gives some pious speeches. Okay? That's the haftarot of King Solomon for Sukkot. And here's what went through my mind. This is where Jewish values and culture are in hot and creative tension with American values and culture. I thought to myself, it would be like we were going through some religious tradition or an artistic tradition. We're going to showcase the life and legacy of Harvey Weinstein. And they were going to show, this is what I feel. Yeah, you could tell me if I'm off here. But I'm sure there are speeches from Harvey Weinstein years ago where he talks about female empowerment and where he talks about one of his main roles is to get new artists, including new female artists, jobs as actors in Hollywood. And where this religious tradition would exalt the work of young Harvey Weinstein and would quote pious speeches without actually dealing with the problem, but wait a minute, later Harvey Weinstein vitiates earlier Harvey Weinstein, we shouldn't be doing Harvey Weinstein. And it just struck me that it's noteworthy that the Jewish tradition does not do that. Later, King Solomon, who ends up having 1,000 wives and 700 wives turn to concubines. The Bible itself, this is not a woke, modern, lefty critique. This is the Bible itself. The Bible itself says that he strayed badly, that God was angry with him, and that he lost the kingdom. This is the Bible's critique. And my question is, where is that critique and where is that voice of the Haftarot, which only showcase young King Solomon? So let's thank God for the gift of learning Torah together. And then we will get into it. Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu Melech HaOlam, Asher Kidishanu B'Mitzvotah Ritzivanu L'Lasot B'Divrei Torah, V'Harev Na Adonai Eloheinu Et Divrei Toracha B'Fino U'B'Fi Amcha B'Yisrael, V'Niyeh Anachnu Tzatzeinu B'Tzatzei Amcha B'Yisrael, Kulanu Yodei Shemecha V'Lomdei Toratecha L'Shma, Baruch atah Adonai Hamalamei Korah Ba'amo Yisrael. Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu Melech HaOlam, Asher Bachar Banu Mikol Amin, V'natan Lanu Et Torato. Baruch atah Adonai Nodin HaTorah. So what I want to do is some quick text work so that we're all reading from the same hymnal. Let's look at these texts together, which will ground our conversation. And I also want to read the story of King Solomon backwards. I want to read the story of King Solomon with what we know now and ask ourselves what happened to this piece of the story and the part that is featured in the Haftarot. So first I'll turn to page 7, which is the laws of Deuteronomy, Shoftim, which law sets forth what happens if the people want to have a king. And you'll see this is the Torah talking. Moreover, he, the king, shall not keep many horses or send people back to Egypt to add to his horses. Since the Lord has warned you, you must not go back that way again. And he shall not have many wives. lest his heart go astray, nor shall he amass silver and gold to excess. Right? So not too many horses, not too many wives, not too much silver and gold. Okay? Now, let's take a look, just so that we're grounded. Look on page, this is 1 Kings 10. Look on page 10 of 1 Kings 10, page 10 of our handout. There's just a whole bunch of stuff here about gold. The weight of the gold which Solomon received every year was 666 talents of gold, besides what came from the tradesmen. And then all of King Solomon's drinking cups were of gold, and the utensils of the Lebanon forest were of pure gold. Silver did not count for anything in Solomon's days. He just gold, gold, gold. Marsha, Marsha, Marsha. So don't have too much gold, lots of gold. Then don't have too many horses. Look on page 11. Solomon assembled chariots and horses. He had 1,400 chariots and 12,000 horses, etc., etc. Solomon's horses were procured from Mitzrayim. A chariot importer from Mitzrayim cost 600 shekels, etc. So he went back to Mitzrayim to get his horses. So not too much gold, ton of gold. Not too many horses, a gazillion horses. But then you'll see that the critique of Solomon levels up. It gets more dramatic. Now comes the wives' business. King Solomon loved many foreign women, in addition to Pharaoh's daughter, Moabite, Ammonite, Edomite, Phoenician, and Hittite women from the nations of which the Lord had said to the Israelites, "None of you shall join them, and none of them shall join you, lest they turn your heart away to follow their gods." Such Solomon clung to and loved. He had 700 royal wives and 300 concubines, and his wives turned his heart away. In his old age, his wives turned away Solomon's heart after other gods, and he was not as wholeheartedly devoted to the Lord his God as his father David had been. Solomon followed Ashtoreth, the goddess of the Phoenicians, and Milcom, the abomination of the Ammonites. Solomon did what was displeasing to the Lord, did not remain loyal to the Lord like his father David. And then Solomon's big claim to fame is he's a builder of the temple. This is the end of his legacy. At that time, Solomon built a shrine for Chemosh, the abomination of Moab on the hill near Jerusalem, and one for Molech, the abomination of the Ammonites. And he did the same for all his foreign wives who offered and sacrificed to their gods. The Lord was angry with Solomon because his heart turned away from the Lord. So, just the pshat of the text has got Solomon violating all three laws. Don't have too much gold, he has too much gold. Don't have too many horses, he has too many horses. And don't have too many wives, he has a lot of wives, too many wives. And they cause him to be an idolater and an apostate. And he's now building shrines and doing avodah zarah. Okay? By the way, that's just the pshat of the Bible. That's not a lefty woke critique. If you want to add a lefty woke critique for no extra charge, he is very much Harvey Weinstein on steroids. Because this is a lefty woke critique, not the pshat. But Harvey Weinstein is about power differential, wealth differential, status differential, using power, wealth, money, status to have sex with women who have less power, less wealth, less status, right? That's the sin of Harvey Weinstein. Use your power, your status, your cachet to have sex with women who otherwise would not have sex with you. That's what the king does on a big scale. And that is not in the chart here, but obviously we read this with modern eyes. Now, with all that as background, I want to just come, and then we'll start the conversation with colleagues and we'll continue it. The Haftarah for Sukkot just make no mention of the real King Solomon. And if you look on page 3, this is the Haftarah for the second day of Sukkot. And page 3, "Now my father David had intended to build the house for the name of the Lord God of Israel. But the Lord said to my father David, as regards your intention to build the house for my name, you did right to have that intention. However, you shall not build the house yourself. Instead, your son, the issue of your loins, shall build the house for my name." And then, look at me. Marsha, 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 look at me. "The Lord has fulfilled the promise that he made. I have succeeded my father David. I have built the house for the name of the Lord. I have set a place for the ark containing the Dedat out of Egypt." Okay, so that's the first one. And then, finally, and now our conversation can begin. Look on page 5. in the Haftarah for Shemini Atzeret, you have pious King Solomon, and he gives this big speech. Praise be the Lord. I'm reading on verse 56. Praise be the Lord who has granted a haven to his people Israel, just as he promised. Not a single word has failed of all the gracious promises that he's made. May the Lord God be with us as he was with our fathers. May he never abandon us or forsake us. So this is really Deuteronomy kind of covenant. God did for us, we should do for God in response. And then, may he incline our hearts to him that we walk in his ways and keep the commandments, the laws, and the rules which he enjoined upon our fathers. And at the very end, may you be wholehearted with the Lord our God to walk in his ways and keep his commandments even as now. A very pious speech about following the laws of the Torah. But we now know that Solomon did the opposite. So, I want to start with my colleagues. Here's my first question. I guess let's lay out the question. The first question is, what happened to King Solomon? Like, what happened to his neshama? What happened to the soul of King Solomon? Did he mean this pious stuff when he said it? Did he not mean it when he said it? Did he mean it when he said it? And then how do you go from that to a thousand wives and building altars and abominations to these false gods? Second, we're going to take a look at what do you do when your heroes fail? And we're going to look at the rabbinic response to that. And the third thing is my analogy that what I felt to Harvey Weinstein, this is like showcasing a speech from Harvey Weinstein about female empowerment, is that unfair? Or is that exactly actually on target? And what are we supposed to get of the fact that religious tradition does not actually deal with the totality of Solomon's life? So, first, the neshama of King Solomon. What happened to King Solomon?
So, can I say something before we start?
Yes.
We love each other, and you can see that we tease each other all the time. One thing that always fascinates me during Talmud class is when you are talking and presenting the theme, Michelle is boiling inside. She's always boiling to do an answer and says, oh, what is she saying? And Michelle, I will give you the privilege to speak first.
Thank you. No, I happen to be pretty removed because actually a piece of what you said and a piece of the question feels to me to be somewhat off target to the religious drive here of what's going on. The Deuteronomic voice that is coming through, and it was beautiful the way you framed it, says, don't do kings. Just don't do kings because no human being can be the kind of king that the King of Kings is. And it feels to me, you're asking about Solomon the man, but these texts are Solomon the character, Solomon the king, who by definition has to, it's almost there's this sort of biblical tragedy that's built. He kind of has to check the boxes. It's just too perfect, right? Deuteronomy says your kings are going to do this. And then we come along and we read the story of kings and, in fact, check, check, check. And so there seems to be a really agenda-driven conversation here that it's surprising to me that we don't spend a lot of time on anymore in our day and age because there's this really powerful theological argument that all of us, in some sense, would fail as kings. That anyone, even, David's son, David was not worthy. King Solomon, it looked like he was worthy, maybe. But in the grand scheme of life, you cannot expect anyone to fill out that role model of a king because kings, by definition, are human. And humans, by definition,
Can I say something regarding that, please? I believe, correct me if I'm wrong, that you are trying to separate the category of king to any regular people, and it's not the case.
No, I'm actually
every
doing
every human
the
being who, first of all, every human being doesn't need to be a king to have his own favors, right? That's one number two. And the two is that in any kind of power,
that's exactly Deuteronomy's point,
right,
which is what I'm trying to say, is that you put anyone there. It doesn't matter how many pious speeches and how many wondrous deeds they have done. Kingship, by definition, is a corrupting category.
Right. So what you're saying, if I could distill what you're saying, it is the truth that power corrupts, absolute power corrupts absolutely. Right?
I think that's the Deuteronomy. Right. I don't know why I can't say that word this early in the morning, but that's
right.
The voice of Deuteronomy here in this.
Right.
This
power corrupts, and absolute power corrupts absolutely. And what I hear you saying, Elias, is it's not just power that corrupts. It's all of us have souls that are vulnerable to corruption. I mean, kings are especially vulnerable to corruption because of all their power, but any human is. So I guess here's my I'm just curious as to Solomon the person. I get what you're saying about the category, etc. Like, what happened to him? What happened to him? And specifically, even though we're not kings, what does the deterioration of his soul, the corruption of his soul, 1,000 wives? I mean, the guy is far gone. What does that teach us about us? What does that teach us about us? And how do we not do that? What safeguards do we have in our lives, since we're all vulnerable to our own form of corruption? What safeguards do we have so that we don't become Solomon in 1 Kings 10? And then why, and specifically, this is what kind of grates at me, why does our religious tradition whitewash King Solomon? You come to Shul, if the time that you give to your religion is synagogue time, and you're not a Bible scholar, you would never know about the corruption of King Solomon. All you would know about is pious King Solomon. Why don't we teach this? Why do we whitewash this? Mr. Nesson.
First of all, I wanted to, there's one part of this text that was really fascinating to me, and it actually relates to a phrase that you use quite often, which is happy wife, happy life. And you see, so first of all, yes, he did go off the rails, but he wants to be like everybody else. All the other kings do this, so therefore, I want to be like all the other kings, which of course is antithetical to what Judaism is just trying to present. But then, if you read that text carefully, it says that he built all of these altars for these abomination gods, so that his wives could worship there. So that's kind of, I think we can all look at ourselves and say, there are so many times that the things that we think we stand for sometimes are ameliorated by making sure that our relationships stay intact and have these be compromised there. I think it's a really sort of complex thing. Now, so that's just one kind read of what happened to Solomon.
You're defending Solomon because he's a nice husband.
Kind of. It's not a total defense, but I think it's a view of reality.
Can I say something?
Yes, please.
All right. Thank you, Wes. This topic is unbelievable. And so many things to talk. First of all, in modern eyes, okay, Solomon didn't discriminate. He had Edomites, Adomanites. I mean, he wasn't racist. He didn't care about interfaith. He was, let's go, How do you deal with 1,000 wives? Yeah. Honey, you should do this and that. Imagine that 1,000 times.
Right.
That is unbelievable. Okay. No, but seriously, now, a couple of things that I want to mention. First of all, not only that we read about great Solomon the king, he's supposed to be the author of Shir HaShirim,
right?
That Kohelet,
right?
And Mishle, the Proverbs. All right. So wow, what? Yeah, that's unbelievable. And obviously, our tradition is highlighting the good things. Now, one thing that there are two things, and I'll let you talk about this. One is, I think he was a politician. He said the right things in order to get to power. Okay, that was his soul. His real soul was the later part of his life and not the early part where he checked all the boxes, as you said. The second thing is, let's remember that he was born from Bathsheba. And Bathsheba got pregnant from King David while she was married to another person. Okay, so psychologically, how much does that affect his life? Oh, my father was this king who was fabulous, but really, look what he did. If he did that, I can do that. So many times we look at our parents and we imitate them by their actions, not so much for what they say. And I'm wondering how much the psychology. And then the last thing that I want to mention is fascinating. At the very end of the story, God's reaction to Solomon. He says, I'm going to take away the kingdom from you, but not now, when you die. why does he add that? Why does God do that?
Okay. So I wanna focus in on a couple things you said and bring in the voice of the Talmud on King Solomon. Like, what are the rabbis of the Talmud do? One of the questions that flows from the comments lies is, Solomon is reputed to be wise. I mean, he's so wise that he writes Kohelet, and he's so wise that he writes Mishlei, and he's so wise that he writes Yoreh Shirim, and it doesn't feel wise to have 1,000 wives and do all these altars to foreign gods. So what happened to the wisdom of the wise king? And that, in turn, I want to just focus this on us, not on Solomon. What do we learn about how not to explode our own lives from King Solomon? King Solomon exploded his own life. And, you know, Andy Stanley says that all of us participate in 100% of our own bad decisions, right? All of us participate in 100% of our own bad decisions. We have nobody to blame for our bad decisions but us for our own bad decisions. And King Solomon is there. I want to surface the question of, King Solomon had it all, and he ends up doing what he did, participating in his own bad decisions. What do we learn from that? So I want to give you a couple of different responses. There's two different responses in the Talmud to it. So look on page 13. And so the question is, and you know, we're still in the holiday season. This is still the season of examined life, and we reflect on our life. When we screw up, how do we deal with that fact? What do we think about that fact? So there's going to be two rabbinic moves about it. Okay, the first one is from the tractate Shabbat, and it's just wild tractate. This is a wild discussion. And it comes in the context of, I think you could call this, I'll just frame this as denialism. This is just denialism. I'm going to deny that what everybody knows is true. I'm going to deny it. It's just not, it didn't happen. Okay? So the Gemara here is going to discuss the big sin of King David first, which is, of course, Bathsheba. We know the story. He gets Bathsheba pregnant and then tries to get Uriah, her husband, to come back from the front lines. And Uriah won't have sex with his wife while his men are fighting, and so then King David sends Uriah back to the front lines so that he'll die. Okay? Listen what the Gemara does with this. Rabbi Shmuel bar Nachmani, we're on page 13 from Shabbat 56. And this will be context for the discussion of King Solomon. The Gemara now discusses the sin attributed to King David. Rabbi Shmuel bar Nachmani said in the name of Rabbi Yonatan, Kol ha'omer David chata, Eino ela to'er. Whoever says David sinned is just wrong. Whoever said David sinned is wrong. And then it goes on. And then, so what do they do with the fact that Natan, the prophet, critiques him? So this is the Gemara's answer. Shebikesh la'asot v'lo asa. David, bikesh la'asot, he wanted to have sex with Bathsheba, but he didn't. V'lo asa, he didn't. Which is such a ridiculous comment, because the entire plot of the story is that he had sex, made her pregnant, etc. So it's just pure denialism. And then you're going to see a similar kind of move. Take a look at page 56b1, which is page 15 of the handout. The Gemara now discusses the apparent sin of King Shlomo. Rabbi Shmuel bar Nachmani said in the name of Rabbi Yonatan, whoever says that Shlomo sinned is simply mistaken. And then the answer is that if you keep looking at the bottom of the page, it is written, and it came to pass at the time, now on page 16, of Shlomo's old age, that his wives turned his heart aside to go to other gods. And then his heart was not perfect with Hashem, his God, as was the heart of David, his father. The Gemara, so it is only that Shlomo's heart was not like the heart of his father David, however, he also did not sin. And then the answer is that it came to pass at the time of Shlomo's old age that his wives turned his heart aside to go after gods, but he did not actually go after those gods. In other words, just like David wanted to have sex with Bathsheba but did not have sex, according to the Talmud, so too Shlomo wanted to build these altars for his wives, but he did not actually build his altars. So you have, this is a famous discussion in the Talmud, And it's famous for being ridiculous because it actually subverts in a really harmful way the actual teaching of it. It's like Fox News does Bible. And the implications for today of denialism, of which is not going to look at the truth. You know, the truth is what it is, and it's a videotape, and you can see it. Right, we're not going to look at the truth. We're going to deny that what we know is true. It's true. David, in fact, didn't have sex with Bathsheba. Shlomo, in fact, didn't build these altars, even though it says that he did. That's one approach. So, colleagues, what about this? I mean, and do we have the seeds of the Talmudic discussion here of page 56 in our own heart and in our own soul when we examine our own ways? Elias and Oro.
Yes, thank you, Wes. So I wanna ask the two of you a question, because many times over and over when you teach Seth, you mention in general that the period of kings in Judaism wasn't successful. And then after that, the kingdoms were abolished, okay? And we believe in rabbinical Judaism. How is it possible that these tractates were written maybe 1,200 years after King Solomon, and they are defending something that in our Judaism tradition is not defendable?
Right. That's the question. Like, why? That's the question. Why do something that's indefensible? Why defend the indefensible? And by the way, what the Talmud does here on page 56, this is what our nation is literally going through. It's literally, we are reenacting Talmud Shabbat 56 right now, right? Whereas we're defending the indefensible. In our case, it's actually, you can actually see it on TV. We actually live through it. And yet there is an instinct in people to defend the indefensible. And that is what is happening with this tractate. That is what's happening with half of our country right now on January 6th. So what is it about the human condition, Michelle, that would inspire somebody to defend the indefensible?
Well, I think you could look at it from all – you could come at that from so many different angles. I'll give you just a few, right? One angle that you would come at that from is this is our hero. This is somebody who we read the Haftarah on Sukkot, Haftarot, right? This is somebody who is a role model for the ages. You know, stop bringing up the bad stuff that they do. We need heroes, right? And this was actually a very big thrust in Israel, for example. There was the sort of deconstruction of Masada, for example. You know, they were heroes. No, they're not heroes. And there's this whole sort of self challenge within the psychological and emotional well-being of sort of modern Israelis as they looked at this story that I grew up with that was really important to me is now being challenged. It's about 20 years ago that this sort of cultural gestalt about what does this story mean to me if these heroes were not heroes happens again and again for all of us, right? What happens when literally in our time, right? If you want to use your example, Harvey Weinstein, like, right. What do I do with that person who I used to admire? And so one instinct is that.
Right.
The other possible way that you could get at this has nothing to do with my heroes, but instead has to do with a sense of, like, I don't want to really confront the fact that we as human beings have this tremendous capacity for destruction, for evil, for what this text calls sin, right? Whatever sin means for us in our lives, I don't want to look at that. I want to just build a world.
So can I just name this? I think what the Talmud does in Shabbat 56 is religion on its worst day. It's American culture on its worst day. It is human nature on its worst day. On its worst day. Don't do this. Because if the purpose of religion is to make us the best version of ourselves, then the only way that that happens is if we're honest about our failings and we grow from our failings. But if you say failings, what failings? There's no failings. Actually, David never had sex with touch it, but he wanted to, but he didn't. And Solomon never built an altar to a false god. He wanted to, but he didn't. January 6th didn't happen. It was just tourism.
But that's right? Why this text is so remarkable, because it is so singular. That's not the thrust of most of our religious tradition.
Right.
We actually, this is really an aberration within our thinking, which usually prizes very much taking the unvarnished truth.
So then here's the question. So now I want to come back to the oriented question with a few minutes left with this part of the conversation, which is why was it a mistake to have King Solomon, his pious speeches as the Haftarot, given all this other stuff that most shul goers never know about?
Can we look at the other piece of Talmud? Because I think that one is much more in line with the rest of our tradition.
So this is if you look on page 17 and 18, this is another approach to the Talmud. Like, so the Talmud's trying to figure out, how did Solomon, such a wise king, how did he allow himself to deteriorate to such a moral menace? So this is the second answer. So the first answer is denialism. Second answer. The Gemara demonstrates that Solomon transgressed two of the prohibitions that apply to kings, bottom of page 17. Rabbi Yitzchak said, why were the reasons for the commandments of the Torah not revealed? Because when the reasons for the commandments stated in two verses were revealed, the great one of the world, Solomon, stumbled over them and transgressed them. Continuing, it is written, he shall not multiply wives for himself, so that his heart will not turn away from God. Solomon said, I'll multiply wives, but I'm not going to turn away my heart from God. Ultimately, however, it is written, it was at this time of Solomon's old age that his wives swayed his heart. Right? So you have the Talmud here acknowledging what was in the text. The second verse, it's written, he shall not multiply horses for himself and shall not return the nation to Egypt in order to multiply horses. And Solomon said to himself, I'll multiply horses, that's fine, but I will not return the nation to Egypt. Ultimately, however, it is written, and the chariot left Egypt worth 600 silver coins, etc. And what I think is going on in this text is it's a much more honest approach, and it tries to get at this question, how, this is Andy Stanley's formulation, us being our own worst enemies. When are we our own worst enemies? Because we participate in 100% of the bad decisions in our lives. We make 100% of the bad decisions in our lives. And how does that happen? And here you see the power of rationalization. You know, I know I'm not supposed to have wives because that's going to incline my heart towards idolatry, but I'm strong, I'm king, I'm wise. I'm going to have my cake and eat it too, times 1,000. I'm going to have 1,000 wives, and I'm not going to be an idolater. And I'm going to get horses, but I'm not going to hoof Egypt. I'm not going to Egypt. And I'm going to start with the horses, and before you know it, he's back in Egypt. And so it's about rationalization that enables us to become our own worst enemy. So, colleagues, Michelle, you brought this up.
I brought it up because I think it's a really powerful moral message, and it's back in line with the sense that, you know, Solomon's example to us is not just Solomon the man, but also Solomon sort of the template for how we might understand our lives and our world. And I think as a template here, it's saying if you think that you're going to escape what befalls our human nature by human nature, you are incorrect. And the greatest example of that, in some sense, is indeed Solomon. If anyone could have done it, it might have been him. But even he couldn't do it.
And so here's my question. You're all educators of children. You all have bar mitzvah children that you educate, and younger and older and teens. How would you teach this material to our kids? If your bar bat mitzvah had a haftarah that's pious King Solomon, and they were drawn to want to talk about the haftarah and pious King Solomon, what would you do with that material? And would you bring out the rest of the story?
I would say yes.
Bring
out the rest of the story, because you know our kids are very sophisticated, they're very smart, and they want to know. I think it's important. Also, I think it's a good lesson to teach about cautionary tales. The fact that one of the reasons that we survive as a religion and as a people is because we, despite the fact that sometimes we have the denialism in our text, that we survive because we are not afraid to examine ourselves and our lives. You know, given we just had Rosh Hashanah Yom Kippur, we have an opportunity all the time to be careful, to be able to be better. And the other thing is that, like Michelle, you said earlier, one thing I want to reply to is that the idea that that from the beginning, literally from the beginning of the Torah, which you're going to start reading soon, we realize that the thrust of our lives as human beings is the fact that we are flawed from the beginning, and that our goal is to try to work past our flaws as best we can. And the truth is that it's a work that can never be complete. It's something that goes to the end of our lives.
Lord Essen, you are the king of ritual at Temple Emanuel. Do you think Judaism is guilty of the sin of whitewashing King Solomon's really bad qualities and really bad story in how we offer up King Solomon to our people?
I haven't had a chance to really process that. I'm sorry.
Can I jump in?
Yeah, I want to say something that I mentioned earlier. Maybe we can dedicate another class to this. What I believe that the Talmud people, sages, and rabbis are doing is that they are just following the thought, the biblical thought of what God said to Solomon. God said to Solomon, "You've sinned. You looked away from religion. I'm going to take away the kingdom from you, but not now. Okay, so what you've done in life, you have a good end to your life. I will do it only because of your father." So in God's eyes, King David was unbelievable, and he did nothing wrong with killing Bathsheba's husband.
No, just the opposite.
What are you talking about? He says, "In honor of David, I won't destroy your
kingdom." But yes. King David's life is completely broken after this. His kingship is broken. His family is broken. He has a daughter who's raped by a son. That's not Nachas. Then he has another son.
So why does God say that?
That's not Nachas.
So explain to me why does God say that?
Well, the Tanakh is very clear that David pays big time for his sin of Bathsheba. He loses his family. He loses his kingdom. He loses his good name.
Yeah, but what he doesn't lose is God. Right. I think actually that's an important point, Elias, because actually that is one of the major thrusts of our tradition, that David actually maintains a really profound relationship with God and is considered to be a flawed hero, right? And you know, in modern context, that's really challenging for us because we all want to cancel David. It's very easy to cancel David.
I don't
want to
cancel
David.
That's my son's
but
name.
David, right, right. But at the same time, there's so much about him, and there's such a powerful countercultural message within Judaism that all of us can hold complexities and deep and powerful flaws and deep and powerful sins that we hold. We don't like to talk about sin in Judaism, but David did sin. And he continued to work on his relationship with God.
We like to talk about sin in Judaism. That is the reason we have every single year, Ashamnu, Bagadnu, and Alchet Shechatanu Lefaneja. In the American culture, we don't want to talk about sin.
So, guys.
Can I go back to your question?
No, because we have to close.
Please, you remember that show in the early 2000s, Who Wants to Be a Millionaire? That some people who were contesting, they said, "I need to ask the audience for help." Okay. Wes asked me at the beginning of this class to do a song. About these 1,000 wives, I'm completely speechless. No idea what song to sing. Any ideas? Because I have like 5 minutes. I haven't been able to come up with any song. Are they short? Are you low? You know, what should I sing?
What about something from the penitential psalm, which is written by David, and it reflects Ahashalvi, for example.
Okay, thank you. So you conclude the class and then we'll...
Yeah.
Thank you,
everybody. Wait. I want you to get back to your summing up because I love Dan's message. And you know, Dan, it's so powerful. And I want to say that my true and honest answer, because I've been doing this for 23 years, I have never taught the end of Solomon to any bar or bat mitzvah student ever.
Right. So here's what I want to say. I want to end with the following thought. You know, in general, when there's a creative tension between American culture and Jewish culture, I tend to side with Jewish culture. But I actually think the way American culture has handled Harvey Weinstein is exactly right, making him a pariah. And I think Jewish culture has suffered. I think we are guilty of the sin of whitewashing. I think the fact that you've had 23 years of bar mitzvah kids and bat mitzvah kids, and you've never mentioned the fact that Salma was a moral degenerate.
Not just because I didn't want to, but actually because it's not
something nowhere,
that our,
it's right,
that our
you
tradition
have to go to West Coast. No, let me just finish. So I think to me, what we're doing on Shmini Atzeret, listening to King Solomon's pious platitudes that his actual life undermined, would be like, let's have a whole film night to celebrate Harvey Weinstein, and we're going to show Shakespeare in Love, and we're going to listen, and we're going to frame Shakespeare in Love by having young Harvey Weinstein talk about female empowerment. We're guilty of that sin, and I think Judaism has something to learn.
Okay, so my question to end the class is, to you?
Yes.
You always pose the question.
Yes.
Should we be judged by our whole life, or what, by our worst moments? So clearly,
yes,
here for you,
right,
is worst moment.
Yeah, we should be judged by our worst moments.
So,
because I'll tell you why. Because if we live, I'm always, to me, this is the modern story that I live in fear of. This is the Cincinnati Reds sports announcer who does baseball games, and there's 162 baseball games. He does it for many, many years. He's announced a gazillion, like tens of thousands of innings of baseball. It's also a generational connection because his father had the job before he did. And once on a hot mic night, he makes a homophobic slur. He loses his job that night and he's toast. So 1,000, 10,000, thousands of thousands of innings, one bad hot mic moment.
What about the Shuba?
So
let
wait.
Me finish. Let
what
me
about
finish.
The Shuba?
Let me finish. If you want to live your best life, you are wise to live with the awareness of that reality, that you will be judged not on the basis of your finest hour. You will be judged on the basis of your final hour. And if you live with an awareness of that, it should hopefully, you know, we say in the Machzor, Sarnu Mishpatecha V'lo Shaveh Lanu, it just wasn't worth it. If you live with an awareness of that, that you are in fact 40, I mean, I'm completely acutely aware of this. I'm a rabbi for 25 years. One false move and nobody gives a hill of beans about 25 fine years. One bad move, 25 years, gone. And you've been a canon for however many years. You've taught a gazillion students. I've been there when you're teaching students at 4 o'clock, 5 o'clock, 6 o'clock, 7 o'clock, 8 o'clock, and then you go and put on a gorgeous show. You do that every day. You do that Thursday night, and you do that for 30 years, 40 years. One bad move, you're toast, Elias. Nobody's talking about, oh, my God, he was so great with bar mitzvah kids. Nobody's talking about, oh, my God, he did amazing concerts. Nobody's talking about he was a star voice and he had a work ethic. Nobody gives it about that. You do one false move, that will define your legacy. Elias, God forbid, he's the cantor who did yada, yada, yada. So I think this is religion on its worst day, and I think that we would be much better served by living with an awareness of how our actions have consequences, and hopefully that should guide us to do the right thing. Can you please end us with a song?
No, all I wanted to say was David does have the consequences. Even Solomon has the consequences, past the part that you underlined, is
right.
That God, who literally spoke twice to Solomon, is profoundly disappointed, and
yeah,
his life actually does have the consequences. So it's not that we don't believe that these icons were actually, that they had consequences for their actions. But we continue to tell their story, and we continue to grapple with their story. And I just want to thank you, Wes, for bringing up this coda to Solomon's story, because it is surprising that we spend so much time talking about David's failures,
right,
and we spend no time talking about Solomon's failures. And so thank you for surfacing that.
Thank you. Okay, so no song today. You've got a bar mitzvah family, and we've got a conversation to continue, and our live stream will close now, and then we're going to continue the conversation, and then end with Kaddish Rabbanan.